this morning. I'm Jane McCready, the pastor here at Faith Lutheran Church in New Providence, New Jersey. Today is Sunday, February 28th. It is the second Sunday in Lent. With me this morning are my colleagues, Shay Veloso, our minister of music, and Pastor Bob Creesa, a pastoral associate here at Faith, as well as John Everson, who is our assisting minister this morning. My thanks to all of them for keeping me company today, as well as Alex Bonenberger and Gary McCready, who are recording our service for us today. Just a few announcements and notes before we begin. Our advisory committee met last Tuesday evening for an open forum program on Zoom, and from that we have a number of links and phone numbers in case you're having problems making appointments for your vaccine. If you aren't on our email list, then you probably didn't receive those, but if you would like those sent to you directly, please contact Joanne in the church office and we will get those off to you. We are collecting vases for a special project at one of our local nursing homes. So if you have some glass vases at home that you're no longer using, you can drop those off in Franklin Nelson Hall, and we'll be using those, as I said, for a special project at a local nursing home. And thanks to all of you who have already dropped off vases for us to use. Soup Kitchen this week, we dropped off 765 sandwiches, along with snacks and baked goods, face masks, clothing, breakfast bars, fresh fruit, a variety of donations that we received and continue to collect each week. We go over to Soup Kitchen, St. John's Soup Kitchen in Newark every Thursday morning. So if you would like, please drop off your donations before 9, and we will get those over there. Let's see, what else do we have? New or changes to the prayer list, we ask that you remember Barbara Sprules, who continues her tests and treatment. For Mike McQuaid, Peter's brother, who had a second procedure this week and is recuperating from that. For Judy and Floyd Hennehan, who are at home and both of whom have serious health issues. We would also ask that you remember the family of Jeff Olson, who died last week, the family of Edward Dobin, who is the father of a friend of Carol Lutz, and the family of Andrea Cosley, who is a friend of mine who died late this week. This Wednesday, we have our midweek Lenten liturgy with an organ recital, and that is on Wednesday at noon, and we would invite you to join us for that. A reminder that you can always watch our services if you aren't there on, when we broadcast them live, but you can always watch them on YouTube or on Facebook. And a reminder as well to our confirmands that we have class again this week, Wednesday evening at 7 o'clock. I would invite you now to join me for our confession. Trusting in the word of life given in baptism and hearing God's call, we gather to worship in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways. mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us. And for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us share with one another a sign of God's peace. Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The first reading this morning is from the book of Genesis, chapter 17. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless, and I will make of my covenant between me and you, and will make you exceedingly numerous. Then Abram fell on his ancestor of a multitude of nations. No longer shall your name be Abram, but your name shall be Abraham. For I have made you the ancestor of a multitude of nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make nations of you, and kings shall come from you. I will establish my covenant between me and you, and your offspring after you throughout their generations, for an everlasting covenant to be God to you and to your offspring after you. God said to Abraham, as for Sarah, your wife, you shall not call her Sarah, but Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and moreover, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she shall give rise to nations. Kings of peoples shall come from her. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The second reading is from the fourth chapter of Romans. For the promise that he would inherit the earth did not come to Abraham or to his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. If it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs, faith is null and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, neither is there violation. For this reason, it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants, not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share faith of Abraham. For he is the father of all of us, as it is written, I have made you the father of many nations. In the presence of the God in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist, hoping against hope, he believed that he would become the father of many nations, according to what was said, so numerous shall your descendants be. He did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which was already as good as dead, for he was about 100 years old, or when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb. No distrust made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, being fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. Therefore his faith was reckoned to make him as righteousness. Now the words, it was reckoned to him, were not written for his sake alone, but for ours also. It will be reckoned to us who believe in him, who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was handed over to death for our trespasses, and was raised for our justification. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 8th chapter, beginning at the 31st verse. Glory to you, O Lord Christ. Jesus began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly. Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you're setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any want to be my followers, let them deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in glory, the glory of his Father, and with the holy angels. chose as a sermon title, The High Cost of Following Jesus. One of the things that I'm always reminded of, and particularly as I get older, when I was very young, growing up in Hoboken, I wanted to become a Boy Scout. My family at that point said to me that it was okay, but I had to remember that if I become a Boy Scout, I've got to do what Boy Scouts do. Evidently, I must have had a reputation at that point of jumping into things and then forgetting about it, moving on to something else. Well, my mom said, if you're going to become a scout, you're going to do what Boy Scouts do. Well, if my mom and dad said something, I knew better than to argue. Well, those thoughts kind of came to my mind when I was reading this gospel, where Jesus is telling his disciples and the crowd that was following around them that if they want to follow him, if they want to become members of this new group who called Jesus their leader, it may be costly. There may be some things involved that they're not overly wanting to do. Jesus says, if you want to follow me, take up your cross and follow me. Now, we've all heard the story of Peter. Peter is one of those kind of disciples that I kind of like. He's never at a loss for words. They may not be the right words, but he's never at a loss for words. And he comes to Jesus and kind of rebukes him, tells Jesus, no, you've got this wrong. That can't happen to you. You can't suffer and die. He kind of forgot the last part about the resurrection. But he's telling Jesus, you can't do this. And Jesus reminds Peter that he isn't speaking about the things of God, but things of the devil, Satan. So he tells him, get behind me. Don't try to tempt me to do something that I'm not called to do. And then he takes those same thoughts and faces the whole group of people that are around him. And I can't help but think about how easy it is for us this day, and probably for a long time, quite easy for us to become members of the church. I was confirmed as a Lutheran in a Lutheran church, and it didn't cost me much of anything. Oh, I had to go to confirmation class. I had to memorize and stuff, but that was about it. It's not very costly. When I began to realize, looking at this text, that being a follower of Jesus is a little bit more than having my name on the register of some congregation. It takes a personal commitment on my part to follow this Jesus, for whom it won't always be easy. We're fortunate in our society that we're rarely brought to task because we're children of God. Our society usually goes along with that and feels that's good, that's what you ought to do. But that's not true everywhere. There are societies where standing up for Jesus Christ might cost you something. In some cases, it might even cost you your life. There are so many, many things in our lives that we hold on to very tightly. Looking at the meditation that holding on to things so tightly that if it's a human hand that we're holding on to, it can be so tight that it becomes painful. And there may be times when we're told, let go. Let it go. There are more important things in life, and I wish that I could say that I've got it all figured out. That all you got to do is ask me, and I'll tell you the things you have to let go. It doesn't work that way. For each of us, our lives are different. Now, friend, we kind of dress up alike. We look pretty close, like each other. But that's about as far as it goes when it comes to letting go of the things that would prevent us from following Jesus, the things that would prevent us from paying the price to be a follower of the Lord. We're different. You're different. Each of you knows the things in your life that stand in the way of your becoming an active follower of Jesus Christ. Now, in most cases, that goes along with being a Lutheran or a Methodist or a Roman Catholic, or, well, whatever the label is we have, that should help us being a follower of Jesus Christ, paying the cross. But not always. Peter found out that there's more to walking and following Jesus than simply lip service. I mean, if you read this gospel story, immediately preceding this story, Peter gives this wonderful confession of who Jesus is. When Jesus asks, "Who do you say that I am?" Peter, first one, says, "You're the Christ, the Son of the living God." And then a few verses later, Jesus tells him, "Get behind me, Satan." And that is part of the kind of religious experience that most of us have. We feel close. We feel that we understand what Jesus calls us to do. And then there are other times that we haven't a clue. Luckily, we follow a Savior who promises us grace, God's grace, a grace that is poured out on us just as we are. I remember when I first began to know that gospel song and sing it and hear it used in Billy Graham crusades, "Just as I am, without one plea, but that your blood was shed for me." So when I consider the cost of following Jesus Christ, when I start adding things up in my own life and I fall short of it, I know that I can still turn to the God who loves me. Come to this God without any pleas at all. I mean, I really wish that I could say, when I get to those gates, that I would say, "Pastor Jane was my pastor." That should count for something. I was a member of a Faith Lutheran church in New Providence. That should count. I'm afraid there's a lot more involved than that. There's a lot more involved in our following Jesus than simply doing what is easy to do, but to be willing to pay the price, whatever it is, to pick up our cross have called us to follow you, to be your disciples. We know we're not always faithful. We know that we don't always count the cost. We know that there are times when we'd rather be doing other stuff. But we also know that your grace surrounds us and supports us. Be with us. Be with us at those times when we feel so good about what we do, and those times when we don't. Be with us, for we ask it through Christ our Lord. Amen. And now the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Oh.
ascended into heaven, and he is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. As we are led by Christ in our Lenten journey of repentance, moved by his compassion for us and for each other, let us pray for the Church, for the world, and all people in need. Radiant God, let your light shine on us. Pour out your love through this family of faith, and make it a community of welcome to all. Lord, in your mercy. Empower your Church to be bold in its witness and in its proclamation of the gospel, so that those who live in darkness may experience the light of Christ. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of creation, you stretched out your hand and created the heavens. We praise you for the sun, the moon, the stars that mark our days and fill us with awe. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of justice, grant to the leaders of our government, leaders of all nations, the will and the wisdom to govern with humility and with justice, ensuring the security and the dignity of all people in their care. Lord, in your mercy. We remember before you all essential workers, first responders, and healthcare providers as they take care of us and of our friends and families during this time of pandemic. Watch over them, encourage them, and strengthen them with your compassion and grace. Lord, in your mercy. God of comfort, you renew our strength and you lift us up when we are weary. Bring peace and healing to all who are hurting today, body, mind, or spirit. We remember before you Ben and Joe, Rosalie, Mona, Floyd and Judy, Paul, Chris and Bob, Annalise, Sandy, Nancy and Bob, Marilyn, Linda and Don, Margie and Evelyn, Fred, Mike, Milton, June, Carol, Joyce, Bob, Michael, Lance, Tony, Jill, Dawn, Barbara, Teresa, and Ellen. We remember before you, ask your grace and compassion on the families of Jeff Olson, of Edward Dobin, and of Andrea Cosley. Lord, in your mercy. We give you thanks and praise for the resources and for the generosity of this family of faith. Continue to bless all of our outreach ministries and partnerships as they continue, even in this time of pandemic. We remember before you the continuing efforts of our soup kitchen ministry, our sandwich makers, Family Promise, Broadway House, our food drives and crop walk, Knit, Purl, and Pray, Petals for Progress, and our outreach to immigrant children and their families at St. Stephen's Grace in Newark. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of hope and promise, remember your covenant with us. Fill us with joy and courage as we awaken to each new day of grace. We give you thanks for all the saints who have gone before us. Let their lives draw us closer to you so that we may journey forward, strengthened by the hope that is ours. Lord, in your mercy.
Into your hands, gracious God, we commend all those for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray now as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now may the Lord Jesus, who walked on wounded feet, walk with you to the end of the road. May the Lord Jesus, who served with wounded hands, open your arms to serve others. May the Lord Jesus, who loved with a wounded heart, open your hearts to love. Go in peace, and may you see the face of Jesus in everyone you meet, and may they see the face of Christ in you. Go now in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Amen.